Morning students, I welcome you all for yet in another session of biology 10th standard. So curious students, we continue ahead with lesson number 8, how do organisms reproduce, part 4. Now students, in part 3 we had studied about the asexual mode of reproduction. Now in that asexual mode of reproduction, students, we studied about the vegetative mode of reproduction in case of plants. We studied which are the vegetative part, that is a root, stem and the leaves, and we studied the reproduction in case of potato, that is a stem tuber, and we studied in case of bryophyllum, the reproduction is by means of leaves. We also studied about the artificial type of vegetative propagation or vegetative reproduction, like cutting, grafting, layering. We also studied the reproduction in case of fungi by the formation of spores. So students, in today's session, we will be studying about the sexual reproduction in case of plants. Okay, so let's study about sexual reproduction. Now there are certain characters for sexual reproduction, so that let us discuss. Now in sexual reproduction, we require two parents, that is a male as well as female, to produce an offspring. Offspring means children, okay, of its own kind. For example, a bull alone cannot produce a new calves. It needs a cow. A female sheep alone cannot produce the new ones. It requires the help of a male sheep to give the male gamete, that is the sperm. Now, sexual reproduction takes place in case of both plants as well as animals. Today, we will study about the sexual reproduction in case of plants. Now, sexual reproduction in case of plants. Now, in case of plants, in the previous session, students, we already learned that the vegetative parts includes the root, the stem and the leaves. So, these three are the vegetative part. Then, which is the reproductive part? The reproductive organ of a plant is nothing but the flower. The reproductive part of the plant is nothing but the flower. It is a flower which is the organ of reproduction. Flowers are produced by a plant for the purpose of reproduction. Now, to understand how the flower will help in reproduction, we have to study about the different parts of a flower. So, we will study about the different parts of the flower. The different parts of the flower is also called as the whorls of the flower. Whorl, W-H-O-R-L-S, whorls of the flower. So either we say whorls of the flower or we say parts of the flower. So now I will just explain you with the help of the diagram and then we will see the writing part. Okay. So now this is the section of a flower. Now in the section of the flower, can you see this part, green colored part here, outermost green colored part? Now this outermost green colored part is called as the calyx. Collectively, calyx, when I say, you know, the calyx is a collective term. Calyx is a collective term. Now, a calyx is made up of individual structures which are called as sepals. So, how many sepals can I see here? I can see two sepals in this diagram. Right now, in the section, I can see two sepals. Sepal number 1 and sepal number 2. So, calyx is the outermost whorl of the flower. The individual members of the calyx is called as the sepals. What are the function of the sepals? You can see the sepals are green in color. Being green in color, it will help in photosynthesis. At the same time, the sepals provide protection to the flower in bud condition. All of you know the bud appears like this and the bud is green in color. The green color of a bud is because it is covered by calyx from all the sides. So students, we have completed with the calyx. Now we are going to study the next part of the flower, and the next part of the flower is called as the corolla. The next part of the flower is called as the corolla. So this is your corolla. So corolla is present inner to the calyx. The individual members, so this is the individual member, member 1, member 2 and member 3. The individual members of the corolla are called as petals. The individual members of the corolla are called as petals. That means when many petals will come together, the collective term for a group of petals of a flower is the corolla. So you can see here corolla here. Okay, now what is the function of the corolla? Now the corolla is brightly colored. Being brightly colored, it attracts the insects for pollination. At the same time, you can see student, there are still some parts which are there inside the flower. So don't you feel the corolla is providing additional protection to the inner parts of the flower? Okay, so these are the two functions of corolla. Now let us do the reading part. I hope all of you have understood calyx, and you can see, as I said again, say sepals, you can see corolla, you can see the different type of petals here. Is it clear? So let's go for the reading part. Sexual reproduction in plants. Flower is the organ of reproduction in case of higher plants. Now parts of a flower. We see the parts of the flower. Part number one, that is a calyx. Calyx is the outermost part of the flower. It is made up of sepals. Sepals help in photosynthesis and provides protection to the flower in bud condition. These are the functions. Corolla. Corolla is present inner to the calyx. It is made up of petals. Function of the petals. The petals attract the insects for pollination and provides protection to the inner whorls of the flower. Whorls of the flower mean parts of the flower. Inner part you have seen. Okay. Now let us move to the next slide. I will first explain you with the picture and then we will proceed ahead. Okay, students. Now, my dear students, you can see here this part here, orange colored part here. Can you see this bulged portion is called as an anther? You can see this is the bulged portion called as the anther. Can you see? And can you see it has got a stalk? The stalk is called as filament. Okay, so let us start now. Okay, yeah. Now, androecium. Now, androecium is present inner to the corolla. Androecium is present inner to the corolla. The individual members of an androecium is called as stamen. The individual members of an androecium is called as stamen. The stamen consists of two parts. The stamen consists of two parts, namely the anther as well as the filament. So one single structure which you are seeing here is a stamen. And when many stamens will come together collectively, for many stamens we use one word, that is androecium. So what is the androecium made up of? The androecium is made up of stamen. What is the stamen in turn made up of? The stamen in turn is made up of two parts, that is the anther and the filament. So all of you can see this orange colored part which you are seeing, the bulge part, that is the anther, and the stalk is called as the filament. And add both of them together, a combination of an anther and filament together results in the formation of a stamen. When many stamens will come together, the collective term for it is androecium. Okay, now this stamen is the male reproductive part of the plant. And this stamen is containing anther. Now the anther contains bag-like structures which are called as a pollen sac. And inside the pollen sac, what is produced is the pollen grains. The pollen grains in future gives rise to the male gamete. Now the male gamete is also called by the word male germ cell. Is it clear, students? I hope you have understood about androecium. Now let us come to the next part. The next part you are going to study is gynoecium. So gynoecium is the innermost roll of the flower. The individual members of a gynoecium is called as a carpel. So this entire structure is called as a carpel. Okay. Now carpel consists of three parts. The upper part, which is called as the stigma. This part is called as the stigma. This part is called as the stigma. Now you can see a tubular structure, a canal like structure, tubular canal like structure. Like tubular canal like structure is called as the style. Can you see the base here, swollen base over here? The swollen base over here is called as the ovary. So a carpel basically consists of how many parts? Three parts. Namely what? Stigma, style and ovary. The carpel consists of three parts. The stigma, the style and the ovary. Now inside the ovary what is present? The ovules are present. Inside the ovary what is present? The ovules are present. What does the ovule contain? The ovule contain the female gamete or the female germ cell. After the process of fertilization, the ovary gets converted to form a fruit, whereas the ovule gets converted to form a seed. Okay, so gynecium is made up of carpel. A carpel is in turn made up of three parts, stigma, style and ovary. The basal swollen part is called as the ovary. The ovary after fertilization forms a fruit and the ovule forms a seed. It is the ovule in which you have the female gamete, which is called as a female germ cell. Okay, let's do the reading part. Yeah. Androecium. It is a male reproductive part of the flower. It is present inner to the corolla. It is made up of stamen. Each stamen consists of a filament and anther. Pollen grains are produced in the pollen sac, which are present in the anther. Gynecium. It is a female reproductive part of the flower. It is the innermost part of the flower. It is made up of carpel. Each carpel consists of a swollen bottom, which is called ovary. Middle elongated part called as a style. And a terminal part which is sticky and is called as a stigma. So this is regarding the androecium and gynecium. So students, now we have discussed about the four different parts of the flower as what? Calyx, corolla, androecium and gynecium. We learned that the calyx is made up of sepals, the corolla is made up of petals, androecium is made up of stamen and the gynecium is made up of carpel. Okay, the male part of a flower is called as the stamen and it is collectively many stamens together will be called androecium. The female part of the flower is called gynecium and gynecium is made up of individual members which are called as carpel. Many carpel together, a single word, collective term, you call it as gynecium. Okay, so we have completed the four parts of a flower as calyx, corolla, androecium and gynecium. Now students, let us go for two definitions. Definitions, there can be two types of flower. One type of flower is called as a unisexual flower. Unisexual, either male or it can be female. The flowers are called unisexual when it either contains a stamen or a carpel. Suppose if a flower is containing only stamen, then that is a male flower. Such a male flower is called as a staminate flower. Whereas if a flower is only containing gynecium, then it is a female flower. A female flower is called as a pistillate flower. Such unisexual flowers as male and female is found in plants like papaya and watermelon. Now let's go to the next definition, that is bisexual flowers. Now the flowers are called bisexual when it contains both the stamen and the carpel. So you can see here it is containing the stamen and here it is containing the carpel. So since both the sex organs are there, the male sex organ and the female sex organ both are present in the same flower, such a flower is called as a bisexual flower. Example of a bisexual flower is hibiscus and mustard. Okay, I hope all of you have understood the terms like staminate flower, pistillate flower and bisexual flower. Staminate flower when only the androecium is present. Androecium is present. Pistillate flower when only gynecium is present. Bisexual flower, androecium and gynecium both are present. So these were definitions. Now students, let's go to the another part, that is pollination. Now, what is pollination? Pollination is an important step in the sexual reproduction of plants. Pollination is the transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma of the flower. You know that the pollen grains are produced by the anther. Now, the anther has to reach the stigma, and the process of transfer of this pollen grain from the anther to the stigma is called as pollination. Now, there are two types of pollination. One is called as a self-pollination and the other is called as a cross-pollination. Now, I will just explain you the self-pollination over here. So, all of you please pay attention. Now, students, this is a flower. This is which type of flower? Now, here you can see this is a stamen and here you can see this is a carpel. So, here I have the stamen and I am having the carpel both. So, it is type of what type of flower? Bisexual flower. So, if it is a bisexual flower, the male gamete will be produced by the anther, the female gamete will be produced by the carpel. Correct or not? Okay. So, they are present, the sex organs are present in the same flower. Only thing I have to transfer, the only thing what I have to do is, I have to transfer the pollen grain. Only thing what I have to do is, I have to transfer the pollen grain from the anther to the stigma. Okay, and this transfer of pollen grain from the anther to the stigma is called as what you know, pollination. Okay, so now let's see the types of pollination. As I told you, there are two types of pollination. So let us see the two types of pollination now. Self-pollination. Now, what is self-pollination? It is a type of pollination in which the pollen grains are transferred from the anther to the stigma of the same flower. You can see here, from the anther to the stigma of the same flower, the entire activity is taking place in a single flower. Since the entire activity is taking place in a single flower, this type of pollination, you call it as self-pollination. Is it clear to you, students? Now, we have another type of pollination, now which is called as the cross-pollination. Okay, we have another type of pollination which is called as cross-pollination. Now, we will see how the cross-pollination takes place. Here you can see I have flower 1 and I have flower 2 here. Here you can see the pollen grain from the anther is falling onto the stigma of another flower. That is, the pollen grain from flower number 1 is moving to flower number 2. At the same time, or you can see that the pollen grain from flower number 2 is moving on to the flower number 1. So, here it is taking place in two different flowers. Okay, which can be located on the same plant or on another plant. Okay, so, but here how many flowers are involved? Two flowers are involved. Since two flowers are involved in the transferring the pollen grain and the stigma to receive it, we call such a type of pollination as what pollination? We call it as the cross pollination. So now let us see the cross pollination here. Cross-pollination. If the pollen grain is transferred from the anther to the stigma of another flower, that means two different flowers are there, another flower, then it is called as cross-pollination. Now, to transfer this pollen grain from the anther to the stigma of the flowers, I require some agents, and these are called agents of pollination. Now, students, here you can see I have shown one agent of pollination, that is honeybee. Insects act as an agent for pollination. Air means wind acts as a agent of pollination. At the same time, water acts as an agent of pollination. In cross pollination, we require agents to transfer the pollen grain. These agents are called pollinating agents. Wind, water and animals like insects are some of the pollinating agents. Now, I hope all of you have understood what is pollination. It is a transfer of pollen grain from the anther to the stigma of a flower. Pollination is of two types. One is a self pollination and the other is a cross pollination. Self pollination will take place in the same flower. Okay, whereas cross pollination will take place in two different flowers. Self pollination, pollen grain from the anther will fall onto the stigma of the same flower. But in cross pollination, the pollen grain from the anther falls onto the stigma of another flower. For cross pollination, we require agents for pollination, that is wind, water and some animals like that of insects. Now let us go to the next point, and the next point is fertilization. So let us see now what is fertilization here. Now students, here this is an enlarged diagram of a carpel. So this is your stigma, this is the style and this is the ovary. Now you know that the depot, what is pollination? It is a transfer of pollen grain from the anther. So this is your anther to the stigma. So you can see the pollen grains are transferred to the stigma. Now in the stigma, the pollen grain is going to germinate. What is germination of the pollen grain? Germination of the pollen grain means formation of a tube. You can see here there is a formation of a tube which is called as a pollen tube. The pollen tube will break the stigma, it will pass through the style and it will reach the ovary. And you know that inside the ovary what is present? Ovule. Inside the ovule what is present is the female gamete, which is there in a word called as embryo sac. That much you don't have now. Okay, so inside the ovule is a female gamete. So the male gamete is there inside the pollen grain. So the pollen grain, after falling on the stigma, it is going to germinate. That means it will form the pollen tube. The pollen tube will break the stigma, it will pass through the style, it is going to reach the ovary. What is the pollen tube containing? The pollen tube is going to contain the male gamete. So the male gamete is carried by means of the pollen tube. Pollen tube will help in the transport of the male gamete from the stigma to the ovary, where into the ovule where the female gamete is present. And there when they meet, they will unite with each other. And the union of the male gamete with the female gamete is called as fertilization. The product of a fertilization is a zygote. The zygote will divide and divide to form an embryo which will develop inside the seed. Okay. Now fertilization. Union of the male gamete with the female gamete to form a zygote is called fertilization. When the pollen lands on the suitable stigma, it starts germinating. That means it starts producing pollen tube. The pollen tube helps in transferring the male gamete, that is the male germ cells, into the ovary. The pollen tube passes through the style, reaches the ovary where the ovule is present. The ovule contains the female gamete or the female germ cell. Okay, and both of them will unite inside the ovule and result in the formation of zygote. Now let us see what happens after fertilization. So here you can see students, this is the flower, okay, and in this flower the act of pollination has taken place. Pollination is followed by fertilization. So fertilization, they have shown this is the way fertilization has taken place. After fertilization, what happens to the calyx? It will fall off. What happens to the corolla? It will fall off. What happens to the remaining stamens? It will fall off. What happens to the stigma and the style? It will fall off. What will only remain is nothing but the ovary. What will happen to the ovary after fertilization? It will get converted to form a fruit. What will happen to the ovule after fertilization? It will get converted to the seed. What will happen to the zygote after fertilization? It will get converted to form an embryo. Okay. So this is what is called post-fertilization changes. That means after fertilization, what is going to happen? So here I have shown a fruit, inside that is a seed will have an outer covering called seed coat, inside that embryo is there, and food is provided by a structure called endosperm, which is not there for you as such. Yes. Now, The zygote divides several times to form an embryo. I told you the zygote gets converted to form an embryo within the ovule. The ovule develops a tough coat and is gradually converted into a seed. Ovule gets converted to form a seed. Ovary grows rapidly and ripens to form a fruit. What happens to the petals, sepals, stamen, style and stigma? They shrivel, shrink and fall off, as I discussed earlier. So students, we have completed with sexual reproduction in plants. We studied about pollination, we studied about fertilization, we studied about post-fertilization changes, and in the initial part, we studied about the parts of the flower. Okay, now I hope that all of you might have understood how the flower is a reproductive organ and how it helps in reproduction in case of plants. Now let's move over to the assignment. Students, distinguish between unisexual and bisexual flower. You know that only stamen or carpel, then it is unisexual. Unisexual flowers can be of two types, staminate or pistillate. By example, you have to write papaya and watermelon. And bisexual flowers, androecium and gynoecium present in the same flower. Bisexual flower, hibiscus and mustard. Cross-pollination and self-pollination, all of you know. In the same flower, the transfer is taking place from the anther to the stigma, self-pollination. Cross-pollination will take place in case of the two different flowers. Define fertilization and the process of fertilization in plants. So, define fertilization, how it takes place, and process of fertilization, that is the pollen grain germinate, passes through the style and all that part you explain. Okay, explain the post-fertilization chain, zygote getting converted to embryo, so ovule getting converted to seed, ovary getting converted to fruit, stamen, style, okay, stigma, sepals, they shrivel and shrink and shrivel, shrink or shrivel and they fall off. Okay, I hope you have understood today's session. Thank you.